everyone. Welcome to Everyone Has a Story with Wiser Page. Our guest artist today is a lovely man called Otto Deutsch, who has come here to tell us his heartbreaking story of the Austrian Kinder transport in 1939. Otto, welcome.
Thank you very much. I was born in the beautiful city of Vienna, but my early life in Vienna was less than beautiful. For I had to learn, while still a child, the terrible lesson of racial and religious persecution. It's all such a long time ago, yet time can never ever be a healer. How can I possibly forget that beautiful summer's day, July 1939, when my mother and my sister took me to the mainline station to begin my long and very momentous journey to England. It's amazing that I should remember this so well, for I normally haven't got the best of memories. But when I think about it, it feels as if it was just yesterday. We were not supposed to say farewell. There were announcements over the loudspeaker system warning us that if we showed too much emotion in our goodbyes, this might possibly have serious consequences. In other words, it might mean that we were not allowed to the train. Emotion. What they really meant was we were not supposed to cry. How can you stop a 10-year-old or some much, much younger not to cry, going away in many cases for the very first time from their parents, from their home? Or how can you prohibit the parents not to cry? Well, I was a man at 11 years of age. We men, we don't cry. Oh, girls cry, but we men don't cry. My mother showed me her back because she realized if I was to see her cry, perhaps I wouldn't be such a big man after all. And I always regretted, even after so many years, that I didn't have the last cuddle, which I miss even now. But at least I was able to say some sort of goodbye. But what about my father? He wasn't there. My father that took him on the previous November, on a terrible night which has come down in history as the Kristallnacht, the crystal night, when the Nazis decided they could do with Jews whatever they want. Requisition their homes, smash their furniture, imprison people without any particular reason. Yes, and in some cases, lives were lost. And some of those lives were children. I suppose I considered myself lucky that I was going to go and start a new life in a country which I've heard of before, but of course I've never been away from home, let alone out of the country. And so it was that finally the announcement came that the children could now go onto the platform. The train was ready. We were not allowed to have anyone accompany us. But somehow my lovely sister Adele, 17-year-old, she somehow managed to get to the platform. I suppose it was easier for a young girl, good looking, to manage to persuade people to allow her for the last farewell. Oh, I remember this so vividly. In fact, when I talk about it, I can see it all before me. My cousin was with me, and Alfred and I, we had lucky by the window. I looked out of the window and I saw Adele, Daly we call her for short, start waving her handkerchief as the train moved. She couldn't really keep up very much, for she had an impediment in her walking. But I could clearly hear her voice, and I hear it now, as she said, "Otto, sei schön brav. Wir sehen uns bald wieder. Be a good boy. We'll soon see us. We'll soon meet again." Oh, she must have known that we'll never see each other again. She was 17. She was a grown-up. And that's the reason why she couldn't come on the kinder transport. For the rules were stipulated 6 to 16. And Daly was almost, but not quite, 17. She considered herself a grown-up. Indeed she was. She probably understood what was happening. With me, I wasn't so sure. Why is all this happening? I knew there were some bad men who wanted to do evil to us, but I couldn't figure out just why. What have I done? What have my father done? Daly, what did she do? She wanted to be an opera singer. I used to tease her such a lot. I had this brother-sister relationship with her, a 10-year-old boy and a 17-year-old sister. I remember I must have been a hurried brother, going through her handbag, finding all sorts of things, eyebrow pencils and lipstick and powder. Now, I often think about her, as I do about my mother and father, but especially about Daly, because my mother was ill and Daly had to look after me. I now know my mother had cancer. In those days, we didn't talk a lot about cancer. We didn't know a lot about cancer. So Daly really, despite the fact that she was 7 years older than me, which isn't really an awful, looked after me. And I've got a photo of her, which I treasure. And so the train started. Steam, of course. Vienna isn't a very large city. It can't be compared with London, Paris, Berlin. After a short while, we leave the town behind and the countryside begins. It's amazing. I remember so many things, but I don't remember much about the journey. Isn't that strange? I remember many things before the journey, but the journey, I was exhausted. I was bemused, I was tired, and I wasn't really sure what's going on. Difficult for an 11-year-old boy to try to make sense of the many events which were happening. But there was one event which, even at my young age, moved me very much. When a little girl, oh, she couldn't have been more than 6, if she was that, pleaded with her parents, "Don't send me away. I'll be a good girl. I'll do the cleaning, I'll do the washing, I'll do the cooking." How could she possibly understand that her parents were doing her a good turn, as indeed all the parents did, for sending us away to give us a new life, to give us a new future, because otherwise there would be no future. And so the train just proceeded through countryside, which I didn't know, for I had never been away from home for a long time. Until that moment, when I saw a notice. Strange, the many things you remember. It said, "Holland, 2 kilometers. I don't know how long we traveled, really. Perhaps I should do, but I can't remember. But now I remember we were just in front of the Dutch border. It was a long train. There were many, many carriages. I don't know how many. But I know that Freddie and I, my cousin that is, now calls himself Alfred, we must have been in the last carriage, or one of the last carriages. For the first few carriages were already in Holland. But we were still in German territory. It was a very slow progress crossing the border. The noise that the wagons make when they shuttle. And now comes something which I will never ever forget. And I've got a document to remind me how lucky I am to be alive. For whilst we were still in German territory, an SS man in his black Gestapo uniform came and asked for passport. Well, we had already shown our passport so many times, and yet again. And now comes what I can never forget. And I've got evidence of this, because I still have the original passport. And in that passport, there's a crease in the middle. For as he took the passport of me, he was just about to destroy it. Without the passport, I wouldn't be here today. I wouldn't have been anywhere. He looked at me. And you know, it's amazing, I can see him now, especially that monocle. And I looked at him, and probably in the last moment he gave the passport back to me. I suppose even evil men got consciences. Perhaps he had a boy of my age at home. But that crease in the passport is still there. And so when I feel down in the dumps, as we all do sometimes, when things aren't going too well, I look at that crease and thank God that the passport wasn't destroyed, that he gave it back to me, and that even the very last carriage of that train crossed the border into Holland. Those wonderful Dutch people, I will always be grateful to them. That was the first sign of humanity that we had seen for a long time. That's important when you're only 10 or 11 years of age, or in some cases much, much younger. The first act of kindness, farmers' wives, fruit, flowers, Holland flowers, of course, tulips. I had no idea really what the future would be. I wasn't really sure where I'm going. But now it's history. And you never ever lose the memory of years ago. But it all started long before that. It started way back in March 1938. In March 1938, I wasn't even 10, but I realized that important events were taking place. I had no idea what was taking place, but important events. There was to be a plebiscite, a vote, whether we should be allowed to be an independent nation, to remain an independent nation, or whether we should be incorporated in the great German Reich. What little boy doesn't love marching behind a military band, shouting slogans which he couldn't understand of what it's all about? For my father and so many others marched along the streets of Vienna, shouting, "Ja, ja, ja, yes, yes," that we should vote for an independent Austria, that we should vote to be an independent nation, to remain an independent nation. But it never came to that vote. The vote was to be on Sunday, but it never materialized. For now, I so vividly remember the events that sometimes I'm surprised at myself. It was Friday. Friday to us Jews is a very important day, because in the evening we welcome the Sabbath. And this time, whereas normally this is an occasion of joy, there was little joy, for we had heard the news well before our Sabbath arrived that Austria was to be no more. The Chancellor of the Republic, Dr. Kurt von Schuschnigg, had addressed the nation, and he said, in order to avoid the useless shedding of blood, he had given orders in his capacity as a military commander, chief of the police, chief of the security, that German troops assembled at the border should be allowed free entry into our country. He said he has done this after a lot of deliberation with his conscience and with his colleagues. And so, on that particular Sabbath, Friday night, we still decided that we must do what we always do on a Friday night: welcome the Sabbath with great joy. My sister and my mother would cover their heads and with their hands beckon in the Sabbath. And you know, no matter how poor the families were, and we were very poor. My father was unemployed most of my early life. The Sabbath meal was always the best meal of the week. I don't know how my mother managed it. There was always the traditional chicken soup. There was always the best meal. And even on that Sabbath, we enjoyed the meal, but little else. We went to bed early. There was nothing for us to stay up to. We said our prayers, which we still do, which I shall be saying tomorrow in our synagogue, and went to bed. And when we woke up on Saturday, which is the Sabbath day, we woke up in a different world. A different world altogether. Now here I must explain that for us to have a service in a synagogue or in any house of prayer, there must be 10 men. We call it a minyan. And my father said it's more important than ever that today we go to our synagogue so to make sure that we have a minyan, 10 men. My mother was against this. For goodness sake, don't go today. It could be dangerous. And if you must go, don't take Otto. No. Otto is not yet a man, but he must come with me. I'm seeing this now, so many years ago. And as we walked the short distance to the Humboldtplatz, that's where our synagogue was, people started shouting at us, Jude, Jude, Jew, Jew, Jude verrecke, perish Jew. But these were people who only the day before were our neighbors, our friends. Everybody knew we were Jews, but that didn't matter. We were one community. And my father said to me, don't look behind, just keep walking. Don't look behind. I could hardly keep up with my father, for his paces were much longer and quicker than mine. Don't look back. But I recognized some of my school friends, urged by their parents to shout abuse at us, obscenities, But these were people who only the day before we shared our neighboring niceties. How can that be possible? We arrived at the synagogue. The warden of the synagogue met us and said that we're not going to have a full service today. We're going to have a short service, because by now the people had gathered around the synagogue with all sorts of obscenities. Now here again I must explain, on a Saturday morning, again as we shall do tomorrow in our synagogue in Southend, there is great joy when we take the holy scrolls out of the ark, the Torahs. It's part of the service. The rabbi would read from the Torah, and people from the community would be called up to stand by him. That's a great honor. But we weren't going to do this on that particular morning. Instead of opening the ark where the cherished, what we call Sefer Torahs, are situated, we would lock the arch. Because by now it wasn't only vocal abuse. The first pebbles were thrown at the windows. My father came over to me and said, "Otto, go home. I shall remain." I suppose it was a duty of men to protect our Torah, the Holy Scrolls. Oh, I knew my way home. I knew my way around Vienna. I didn't go home. I went right to the very heart of the city, where our parliament, the beautiful parliament, which was built in the days when Austria was a hub of a mighty empire, in the days of the genial Emperor Franz Joseph. And I saw a sight which, again, is unforgettable. I was just in time to see the red, white, red banner of Austria lowered and the dreaded swastika hoisted. And the people cheered and cheered and cheered. Not everybody, though. There were a few men who had tears in their eyes. It's not a pleasant sight to see a grown man cry. But there were some who did, who realized that the future wasn't going to be very bright. Oh, for a little while, it was to be better. For Austria, like most of Europe, like in this country at that time as well, suffered from terrible unemployment. For a little while, it was better, but not for long, as we now know so well. And so, I watched this momentous occasion when there was to be no more Austria. The name Österreich, that's a German name for Austria, was banned. We were to become the Ostmark. Vienna, the imperial city of Vienna, one of the most historic cities in Europe, became a provincial town. The capital of a province, that's all. And from that day onwards, for us Jews, things became worse every day. At first there were all sorts of petty little laws, which didn't affect me as a boy. What did I care that a Jew couldn't be a lawyer, a doctor? I was a little boy. I was not yet 10. Didn't affect me. But I tell you, it did affect me. When I went to the local park to kick a football about, as I loved to do, and still do. When I saw the notice, "Juden verboten," Jews not allowed. I wanted to ask my father, I don't think I ever did, what is so bad about being a Jew? Why is it so, in a childlike way, naughty to be a Jew? I wonder what he would have said. But all I know is that everyday laws came in, some petty laws, some significant laws. For instance, that we weren't allowed to mingle with non-Jewish children and had to go to our own Judenschule, Jewish school. And 2 days before we were no longer accepted in the ordinary school, the teacher came in the class. Herr Professor Haupt, I remember his name even, who thought I had a great future, who thought I was a very talented child, who rather made a big fuss of me. But now he came in with a swastika armband, and he said that from now, whenever a grown-up comes into the classroom, we would greet him with a German greeting, the Deutsche Gruß, Heil Hitler. This is the man who gave me extra lessons because he thought I was rather good at certain subjects. But now he made my friend Saul and I, the only 2 Jews in the class, sit in the back, for it was not fitting that Jews should sit in front of 100% Aryans. And then came the worst. We had to face our fellow pupils and tell them that we are dirty Jews. And shortly afterwards, we were not allowed in that school building anymore. I had to make a hazardous tram journey to the Leopoldstadt, which was the Jewish part of Vienna. We didn't live in the Jewish part of Vienna. Perhaps I should explain. Vienna had one of the largest Jewish populations in between the two world wars. They were mostly centered in the 2nd and 20th district, but not where we lived. And so, every day, new rules. Our life became more and more limited to what we can do. Yes, even a 10-year-old understood what's happening. I couldn't understand why it is happening, but I understood what is happening. I still couldn't go into the park. Then we saw notices on billboards that the district of Favoriten, that's the 10th municipal district, has to become Judenfrei, free of Jews. And within 2 days' notice, we had to leave our little flat. And I remember my mother, my sister and I pushing a little trolley with a little few possessions we have right through Vienna into the 2nd district, where we just managed to get one room. But where was my father? Ah, yes. My father. Here I got to go back again to the Kristallnacht, to the terrible events which took place, which even to a little boy was significant. It wasn't a joke. It wasn't an adventure. It was sheer horror. For in Paris, a young Jew took it upon himself very foolishly to assassinate a German diplomat at the embassy in Paris. And it was as if the Gestapo, the Nazis, were expecting that. For immediately, knocks on the doors of any Jewish family to be found. But here comes something which I will never understand. I'm now in my mid-80s. I couldn't understand it then, I can't understand it now, what happened. The middle of the night, the 9th of November, a group of young Hitler youths burst into our small little flat apartment. But what was really so terrible, they were led by a man whom I had known as Uncle Kurt. A man who had been the friend of the family long before I was born. In the First World War, unlike the last World War, it was a more personal affair, the fighting. Trench warfare. My father and Kurt Kovac shared the same trench. They both came from the same part of the empire, which is now known as the Czech Republic. When the war was over, they both went to Vienna, seeking fame and glory in the big city, as people went to London. They both lived in the same council apartment. They both married round about the same time. Strange, these coincidences. And Jan Kurt and I were born round about the same time. I was 6 months older than Jan Kurt, who was to be my friend. The son of my father's best friend. They used to go out together looking for work. My father by trade was a pastry cook, but people couldn't afford bread, let alone cakes. So Kurt Kovac, my father's friend, colleague, war veteran, comrade, were so close, we were almost one family. We lived next door to the Kovacs. And you know, when Christian people have Christmas, round about that time, we have the Festival of Light, Hanukkah. And young Kurt used to come into our apartment to watch the menorah, the candelabra being lit, one candle each day. And I used to go in next door to see Father Christmas. There was always some sweet there for me. The fact that we were Jews and they were Catholics, well, we didn't even talk about that. We knew that they went to Mass on a Sunday and we went to synagogue on a Saturday. And it was this, I called him Uncle Kurt. He took me to my first football match that now led this band of young thugs, for that's what they were. There lies my father. Da liegt der Jude. That's where the Jew is lying. The man who was in the same trench with him. They were both decorated soldiers for Austria. And they took my father. I was never ever to see him again. My sister and my mother were to see him again, but I was already in England. And that was a crystal night. And each anniversary of the crystal night, wherever Jewish people congregate, mostly in the synagogues, but small little villages have no synagogues, they will still say that prayer for the dead, the Kaddish, and the rabbi will sing, if there is in the synagogue, the song sung for the dead. So I didn't say goodbye to my father. That day on the station, there wasn't my father, my sister, my mother. And so we were now in the Netherlands, in Holland. And I repeat, I know I've said this before, but it's important for me to repeat, the wonderful Dutch people. And we traveled with the same carriage, but a different engine, from Aachen on the border to the Hoek van Holland. And you know, that was the first time I ever saw the sea. Austria is completely landlocked. There is no sea. And I looked at amazement at that amount of water, the sea. And there was the boat, an English boat, a British boat. And across the sea, across the channel, as I now know, was of course England. But I remember that day when my mother came, cuddled me, kissed me. Oh, I was a man. We men don't like these things too much. When she said to me, "Otto, you're going to England." She had queued up very nearly all night outside the Jewish community center to have me put on the list. England? I knew England was an island. We didn't know much about Scotland, Wales and Ireland. England. It sounded like Engeland, land of the angels. England. I was going to see the sea. I had never been away from home. Yes, when are we going? No, Otto. Not we, but you. There was only 14 days before I left. Not much notice. I have a photo somewhere. The last photo taken together, my mother, my sister, and myself. There was still a photographer, Jewish photographer. And that photo reminds me of my last goodbye. And so came the sea crossing. I can't remember much about it. There are certain mental blocks that you get. You remember something so vividly and something you don't remember at all. I don't know if I was seasick. I probably was. I don't know. I like to think I wasn't. And there, in front of us, was England. No, not the White Cliffs of Dover. That's the romantic part of seeing England for the first time. It was Parkston Quay in Harwich, in Essex. Oddly enough, not too far from where we live now. There is in Harwich a small commemoration plaque to say that's where the refugee children landed. I was now in England. I couldn't speak a word of English, of course. The people dressed different to us. They spoke a language which I never thought I could possibly master or even attempt to learn. I was bewildered, I was bemused, I was confused. I was already homesick. And this time we were put on a train, an English train, the old LNER, London Northeastern Railway, to Liverpool Street. If ever you go to Liverpool Street, have a look outside and see the statue of the Kinder Transport Commemoration Memorial, sculptured by a man whom I know very well, an Israeli, Frank. Got his second name at the moment. I had no idea what's going to happen. Some of the children had places to go to, actually. Not me. Not my cousin. We were all taken into a large, which is now a shopping mall. It's still there. It certainly was there last week. And now, still bemused, still uncertain about our future, we just waited. Waited for what? People were invited to select a child for temporary accommodation. This word temporary is very important. Because after the terrible events of the Crystal Night in Westminster, thanks to some politicians, a law was passed allowing 10,000 children into England on a temporary basis. Of course, then the war started and it was no longer temporary. 10,000 of us. And this action became known as a Kindertransport and is still known. Yes, we still meet each other. No longer 10,000, of course. We're all in our 80s and some in our 90s. And on the 16th of April, that's not so long ago, 200 of us were invited to St. James's Palace by His Royal Highness Prince Charles. And I had a photo taken, which unfortunately I haven't been able to bring with me because it's still to be sent to me. And now, there we were, waiting for people to choose, to select. We all had a little tag and a number, I suppose. The girls went first. Because I suppose the girls, they could use them to help at home and whatever. Alfred and I used to call him Freddy. We must have been the ugly ducklings. Nobody chose us. And so we went back to Liverpool Street, this time on an English train to Ipswich, Suffolk. And from there to what I now know, but didn't know then, was a converted workhouse. I didn't know what a workhouse was. I'm not really too sure now. An old building which was not really fit for habitation anymore. But it was urgency to get the children out. Never mind about how we're going to cope with it. Never mind how we're going to manage it. We got the children out somehow. Get them out. Yes, because it was July. There was only August intervening. The war started in the beginning of September. Get them out. We'll find somewhere. And each day, my cousin and I would go downstairs to look at the notice board to see if anybody is prepared to give us a home. I can't really remember how long I was. Barham House, it was called. Clayton near Ipswich. Oh, I was so proud of my address. An English address at long last. Barham House, Clayton near Ipswich, Suffolk. And in big, large letters, I put England. It's a wonderful experience. And then one day, my cousin came and said, Otto, we're on the list. Somebody's prepared to give us a home. They weren't Jewish people. They were Christians, devout Christians. And the home was to be in a small little market town in the northeast of England called Morpeth. Oh, it's about 15 miles north of Newcastle on Tyne. Mr. and Mrs. Ferguson, Uncle Jim and Auntie Nell. They already had two boys, we were the fourth. They were devout Christians and did so because of their Christianity. One day Uncle Jim, when I could speak a bit more English, explained it to me. Didn't Jesus say, suffer your little children to come to me? But they made sure that we wouldn't lose our Jewishness. For not too far from Morpeth, from Newcastle, a town called Gateshead, where there is a Jewish college for students to become rabbis. And every month one of these students would come up to Morpeth and speak to us to remind us of our Jewishness. We went to school. We were a great novelty. A Londoner would have been a novelty up there, let alone an Austrian Jew. The teacher, yeah, I remember the teachers, I remember the names. Mr. Reid. And I remember the children, I can't really understand what they were saying, but it seemed like, please sir, can we touch him, as if we were from outer space. A Jew they'd never seen that before. They knew about Jews from the scripture lessons, but to see one. And slowly, it was a slow process, I learned English. And here I still love. It wasn't the English that you would speak here. It was good old Geordie land. And I would speak to Uncle Jim. Oh, I had the same ideas people have now, English people, when they go abroad, that they think if they shout loud enough, they're about to understand them. That's what I did. I shouted loud enough. And Uncle Jim would say to me, oh, lovely man, and his wife, well, Geordie Hinney, I didn't know what you're talking about, man. And I can still do it today. And oh, Gascoigne's got nothing on me. And whenever I hear the Geordie talk, it reminds me of those days. Actually, last January, this year, I was a guest speaker on Holocaust Memorial Day in Wallsend, which is in near far from Newcastle. And I was surprised that this Austrian Jew could still speak in their own language and they made a fuss of me. And so life went on. Uncle Jim was just an ordinary van driver, a baker's roundsman. A little town of Morpeth became very important to me. English, well, you don't learn English at school so quick as you do when you've got to learn it, when there's no other choice. I suppose the school children must have taught me all sorts of naughty words to say to the teacher, but the teacher must have understood what's going on. And so I survived. And you know, time is no healer. Indeed, as the years go by, you remember these things more vividly. They become more important to you. They become part of your life. No secret, I was 85 in July. I can't really think about the future, what future at my age, but I think about the past. And the past will never go away from me. And so, I give thanks that I'm here to tell the story. And I feel it's important that these stories should be told. We are often under the auspices of the London Jewish Cultural Center. I sent to Vienna, to Germany. All being well, I'm supposed to go to Berlin in September. To speak in their own language to these children. I've often asked, have I hate? You don't go very far with hate, it's not constructive. Can I forgive? Well, I can't forget, otherwise I couldn't have told you all this. I have no right to forgive. The reason we go and speak to these children, certainly in England, and in Austria and in Germany, is because it's important that the young folk should know about this. The young folk, they are the future. That it must never happen again. But unfortunately, we know only too well, it is happening again. People just haven't learned. And so it is our, I say our because I'm not the only one, quite a number of us, panel of speakers. Some speak about different subjects. Some will speak about their days in Auschwitz. Some will speak, like me, about the Kinder transport. But whatever it is, we can only speak of the past because the future is very uncertain. And I do hope that when people listen to us, they will take note. Now I want to use a word which I use when I speak to school children, as I often do. And that word is an English word, tolerance. Look, what does it matter if we are a different religion, if we're a different color skin, if we have a different culture, if we have a different language? In the end, we're human beings, all the same. And if only they would have realized that we're not different, that there isn't such a thing as a super race and a minor race. For we were meant to be not on the same par as the German master race. But why? Didn't my father fight in the same way for his homeland, Austria? Didn't I look the same as anybody else? Is my blood different? Of course not. And so in our own little way, I say our because, as I say, there's a group of us. We speak, we talk, and we hope somehow that people will realize that we're all the same, and that this shouldn't happen again, even if it does. Thank you.
Otto, would you tell us, share some of your feelings with us, and they must be very painful for you, but when you found out the fate that your sister, mother, sister and father suffered, you know?
Well, yes, I can tell you. Remember, I said to
don't
you,
if it's too painful for you.
Not at all, not at all. These things can never be too painful. They've got to be talked about. It can't be put under the blanket. Remember, I said to you that my sister, Adele, Dele, and my mother were to see my father again. I wasn't there. In the first place, he was sent, as I know now, to build the motorways. You know, when we crossed the German motorways, the old ones, mostly in East Germany, weren't built by trade union labor. They were built like people like my father. And then they sent him home. Now, I've often asked myself, my auntie, two aunties, died in England, in Luton, Bedfordshire. So why didn't my mother come over? I don't know. Mm-hmm. I'm only guessing now. Perhaps she wanted to wait for my father. Mm-hmm. Because my father, mother and sister were taken from the last address in Vienna to a place which not many people have heard of before, not even many Jewish people, Malitrostinek. You might just have heard of Minsk, which is the capital of Belarus. Everybody's heard of Auschwitz, of Belsen, yes, but Malitrostinek, where's that? Well, unlike Auschwitz, it wasn't a camp. There was no selection. There was no slave labor. There was no Dr. Mengele. It was a clearing in the woods. 8 miles, I think, from the center of Minsk. And on arrival, they were just shot. I've got a photo here. 2 years ago, that's as recent as 2 years, I went and paid homage. I stood by a tree which must have been very near to where they were shot. We wanted to put a plaque around the trees. As it says, as it is in the photo, there's a yellow plaque around the tree, one for my father, mother and sister. I had hoped to see there a mass grave. There was no mass grave. With the advance of the Red Army, the Germans, the Nazis, they weren't only Germans, they were Ukrainians and Poles, dug up the bodies, exhumed the bodies, and took them to an incinerator for burning. And it is there that we said Kaddish, which is a prayer for the dead, where the rabbi sang El Rachamon for the dead. And there were, I think, about 11 of us. Two of us from England, myself and a lady from Birmingham. Gentlemen, much older than I, from Israel, from Australia. And we paid our last respect. I'm glad I did that journey. I couldn't do it now. I couldn't do it. And just before that picture was taken, I said the Shema Yisrael. And there I could hold the tears no longer. And I paid homage. Every year, a few, led by a lady who lives in Vienna, is led to this place. Shall not be forgotten. I had to fly to Vienna, and then on to Minsk, and then on to this particular place where the trees. Now, the Germans were very efficient, always are, and each transport had a number and a letter. And as far as I know, the guide said it needn't have been this particular tree, but it was somewhere in that region. They were just shot. And perhaps I should also mention that members of the Einsatzgruppe, the people who were the shooting group, couldn't stand it. Some of them broke down because they were human. And for them, the idea of just facing point-blank people who hadn't done them a thing, who weren't guilty of any crime, just Jews. And it is also important for me, and I stress this now because I'm afraid my voice is going, we realize it wasn't only Jews who suffered. Devout Christians, Seventh-day Adventists, Jehovah's Witnesses, gypsies, oh, many gypsies. They were all like us, deemed to be inferior, that they had no right to be in this world. And I'm glad I got that photo. I didn't know it was going to be taken.
Well, thank you so much for sharing that with us, Otto. It must have been very painful for you, but you came to England, these marvelous people took you and your cousin in, raised you, and you told me how devoted you were to them, how kind. Now, when that finished, has it been a good life?
Yes, it's been a good life, because it always has to be for me a good life, because I think of that crease in the passport.
Yes.
That I'm alive at all. Mm-hmm. Afterwards, when I was 16, I came to London. Like all of you, well, people who were old enough, the Blitz. I was institutionalized. I wasn't very cooperative. I have notes which were now given to me. I was not the best cooperative boy, not the most grateful boy, because sometimes I feel proud that I wasn't the most grateful boy, because sometimes I was sent to places which weren't fit for a little boy. Mm-hmm. Still only 15, 16. But I look back, and I look back with pride that I've not achieved. You see, some of our, from the people of the Kinder Transport, have achieved the highest. We have a noble lord in the House of Commons, in the House of Lords. We have people, the founder of the games, the Olympic Games for the hindered, for difficult to recall. He was a one of the us. We've got people who have the highest in their profession, in medicine, in the theatre, in the arts. And then there's others like me who really haven't done anything particularly great.
I don't believe that.
Other than just...
I don't believe that.
Lead a life. And I think at that
point, I think it's great that you've survived what you've survived. And are just sitting here today. In my book, that makes you a supreme winner.
Thank you very
much. A winner of the human race. Otto, I'm so proud to know you.
I'm very grateful for you giving me
that opportunity. You've touched me so much.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
I'm afraid
for Tony Johnson and myself.
My voice is just about going.
Thank you, Otto. Thank you.